I should say sorry to Dr. Shubhankar. We are not having time to come back to him. If he shares his slides, we'll be able to circulate it among all participants for our benefit. And with this, I will say thanks to Professor V.K. Shotriya, Dr. A.V.S. Ashok, Dr. Shubhankar Chakravarti, and Dr. Anjaneya Sharma for sparing their time and sharing their views with all the participants. Now we are about to start the second session. That second session will be chaired by Professor Ganga Prasad Prasen from Manipur University. And this session will be hosted by or coordinated by my colleague, Professor N. Rokendro Singh. He is now with me. So he will be here to take on what's all the things. One thing I will tell that Professor, my colleague, Professor N. Rokendro Singh is a direct student of Professor Prasen, sir. So I requested him to especially to be here in this session. Sir.
Thank you, Singh, sir. Thank you, Bharatan Singh, sir. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, sir. It is my pleasure to be here in this seminar and to meet my teacher also. And Sir Prasen is a senior most teacher. I'll just introduce in a few minutes, 1 or 2 minutes. Professor Ganga Prasad Prasen is a senior most teacher in the Department of Commerce, Manipur University. He is now Dean, School of Social Sciences. And School of Social Sciences is one of the biggest school in the university, having 14 departments. And he has passed out his master's and PhD degree from the renowned university, Benaras Hindu University. He has completed more than 30 years. And sir has supervised more than 14 scholars, PhD scholars. He has published 7 books, more than 67 research papers. So, sir, I request to sir this to give a keynote speak in on the impact of lockdown on tourism industry in Northeast India. So I request sir Professor Prasen to continue for his speaking. Okay. How to change the screen?
You can unmute it.
No, what did I unmute? Screen change.
Screen change.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, you click on unmute.
Sir,
Is it okay?
Yes.
Oh, okay, sir. Audible now.
Am I audible?
Yes,
audible, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon to everybody. Honorable Professor K.R.S. Sambasiva Rao, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sikkim University. Professor Avinash Khare, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sikkim University. Sorry, Professor K.R.S. Sambasiva Rao, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Mizoram University. Professor Avinash Khare, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sikkim University. Professor P. Subba Rao, Millennium University, Malwi. Coordinator of this webinar, Professor Bharatendu Singh, Professor N. Rokendra Singh, Professor Jyoti Kumar, all their colleagues, learned keynote speaker of the different technical session, delegates, paper presenters. I convey my greetings from Manipur University, Imphal. Coming to my topic, it is impact of lockdown on tourism industry in Northeast region. So I shall be focusing on tourism industry of Northeast region. I have divided my presentation in three parts. In first part, I am telling about the introduction of tourism industry, then different areas or different types of tourism which we have in Northeast region, and also the impact and my suggestion for the development of tourism industry after this lockdown period is over. We all know that in Northeast region, in Northeast India, there are eight states. They are Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, Sikkim, and Tripura. Now, coming to the visit of tourists to this eight Northeast state, we have data up to 2019 only, as provided by the Statistics Department of Northeastern State, that in Arunachal Pradesh, there were 512,436 tourists who came during that year. In Assam, 58,56,282 tourists visited. In Manipur, my state, 1,76,109 tourists visited. In Meghalaya, 11,98,340 tourists visited. In Mizoram, only 76,551 domestic tourists visited during that year. In Nagaland, the total number of domestic tourists who visited in a particular year were 1,05,88 only. In Sikkim, the total number of tourists visited in that very year was 14,26,127, and in Tripura, 4,14,388 domestic tourists visited. When we see the data of foreign tourists, we come to know that in Arunachal Pradesh, 7,653 tourists visited. In Assam, 36,846 tourists visited. In Manipur, only 6,381 foreign tourists came. In Meghalaya, the figure was 18,114. In Mizoram, 967 only. In Nagaland, 5,010. In Sikkim, 71,172 tourists visited. In Tripura, the data, the figure is 1,02,861. When we see the variation, we came to know that in Assam, maximum number of tourists visited in Northeast India, followed by Sikkim, then Meghalaya, then Arunachal Pradesh, Tripura, Nagaland, and lastly, Mizoram. In Assam, as we all are aware that it is a central place. There are, Assam is directly connected with a train, with air route, and sea route also. And also in Assam, there are many places where tourists can go, stay, and meet the people. In Mizoram, the number of tourists visited was least because the communication is not good. There is a problem of inner line permit system also. And so far, there is only one airport in Mizoram, and also only two or three flights from Kolkata, Guwahati, Imphal, and Delhi comes there every day. Therefore, because of the communication problem and isolation from the north, from the remaining parts of India, the number of tourists visited to Mizoram is very less. When we see the data of foreign tourists, we come to know that in Tripura, the maximum number of tourists is 1,02,861. As we know that Tripura is bordering with Bangladesh, therefore it is easy to come to Tripura from Bangladesh, and also for various purposes, tourists from Bangladesh visit to Tripura also. Then in Sikkim, we see the large number of foreign tourists in comparison to other northeastern state of India, because Sikkim is a very popular state. It is bordering with China. There is a popular place called Nathula Pass, where many domestic as well as foreign tourists come to Sikkim. And from Nathula Pass, they can see some parts of China also. So it is a very popular border. And generally, many people who visit Sikkim go up to Nathula Pass to see the China also. Then in Assam, as we know, it is a very popular state. So many people come to see Assam. There is a big Brahmaputra River. There is a very famous ancient Kamakshya Temple. Then there is Kaziranga National Park, the only island, river island, which has been declared as a district, that is Majuli, is also located in Assam, in Upper Assam. So many tourists from India, from abroad, come and see that Majuli Island also. Apart from this, in Assam, there are beautiful hills, plains, greeneries are there, tea gardens are there, temples are there, Shankaracharya, Shankardev temples are there, refineries are there, coal mines are there. Therefore, many tourists would like to see these places. This is the data about Northeast India. Now, coming to the types of tourism or various types of tourism which we have come across in Northeast India is religious or pilgrimage tourism. We all know that in Northeast India, in this IT state, there are people belonging to Hindu religion, Christians are there, Buddhists are there, and people belonging to other religion like Islam are also there. So there are churches in Shillong, in Mizoram, in some parts of Manipur, which were constructed by the British people. So many tourists who belong to Christian religion from India, as well as many tourists from European country, also come and see these churches, which were constructed by their forefather when they were ruling this country. Then there is very famous and very old temple, that is Kamakshya, where Hindus from different parts of India and abroad will also like to come and see. Then they will also love to see the mighty Brahmaputra River, which is the longest river of India, starting from China and coming to India and meeting with this Bay of Bengal via Bangladesh. So they come to see this mighty river also. Apart from this, Assam is also very famous in Namghar and temple, etc., where the people will like to come and see. Then in Manipur, there is a very old temple called Govindaji, and there is old place called Kangla. So these are also religious place in Manipur. So people come here. In Sikkim, there are many Buddhist monastery. So many people, many Buddhist people who are from China, Japan, Thailand, and other Southeast Asian countries who follow Buddhist religion, they also come and visit this monastery in Sikkim. Likewise, people of various religion visit different states of Northeast India to see this old palace and temples, heritage, etc. Then there are many hills in Northeast region. So people come to see these waterfalls, animals, birds. Say in Kaziranga National Parks, the one horn, this rhino is there. There are elephants, deers, tigers, lions, and many other animals are also found in the big Kaziranga National Park. So people come and enjoy this. Then people go to Shillong Hills. There are waterfalls in Shillong, in Meghalaya Hills. The area, the place where largest, where the maximum rainfall occurs in a year, that is Cherrapunji, which is also located in Meghalaya. So people will come to see this Cherrapunji waterfalls, the place where we get the maximum quantity of rainfalls in a particular year. Apart from this, there are orchids in Sikkim. There are forests, there are different varieties of flowers and orchids in the Sikkim state. In Manipur also, we have varieties of orchids. So tourists who are interested to see these forests, these jungles, these trees, animals, orchids, flowers, they do visit and they do this wildlife and adventure tourism in Northeast India. Then we have a large scope of business tourism also. Many tourists, many businessmen come as a tourist to Guwahati, Shillong, Imphal, Agartala, and other places as business tourists, because there are big hotels, there are big seminar halls, conference halls, where they do come and make publicity and marketing of their product. Because in Northeast India, we do not produce goods. We don't have large scale industry. We procure we buy, we use goods produced from other parts of India, like Maharashtra, Punjab, Delhi, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Rajasthan, and many more places. So businessmen from those places do visit frequently in Northeast India, mainly in Guwahati, Shillong, Imphal, Agartala, Itanagar, Gangtok, and make wide publicity of their goods. They do marketing of their product so that we are aware of their product and we buy. So this type of tourism, as we know, called business tourism, is also very popular in this region. Then Government of India has given LTC through year. Any government employee who want to come to Northeast India are allowed to avail year travel. So people come during vacation, summer vacation, winter vacation, puja vacation, Diwali vacation, Holi vacation, as a leisure tourism in this region. And Assam is famous for tea gardens. There are more than 100 tea gardens which were constructed, which were established by the British people. So this green tea gardens is also beautiful scenery in Northeast India. So many people who like to see this greenery, they visit different tea gardens, they enjoy their leisure time there. Then there is another area where we are very much aware is health tourism. We are aware that in Manipur, in Assam, there are many hospitals. Even in Imphal also, there are 2 government hospitals and 10 private very good hospitals. So Manipur is gateway of Southeast Asian country. Myanmar is our neighbor. In Myanmar, healthcare facilities very poor. If they are sick, those people who are living towards the border of Manipur, Nagaland, and Mizoram in Myanmar side, they have to go to Yangon and Mandalay for treatment. For them, Imphal, Guwahati is very near. And our hospitals are cheaper than hospital of their country. Our healthcare facility is very good. We have many doctors. Our rate of health checkup, operation, other charges are very, very reasonable, very, very cheap. Therefore, many people from Myanmar have started coming to Imphal and Guwahati for their health checkup and medical treatment. So this medical tourism is also having good scope in this northeastern state of India. Then another area which can be developed, which is being developed now, is education tourism. In Northeast region, there are many universities. Even now, there are many private universities in Assam. Even in Manipur also, we have 4 universities. In Myanmar, which is backward in education, they have very little number of college and university. So many students from Myanmar have started coming to Manipur, even in Assam also. In our university also, there are many students from Myanmar. So our education in Central University, our fees are very cheap. And we provide good facility to the foreign student. We give direct admission to any student coming from Myanmar to Manipur University, and other university in Northeast India may also follow this practice. So our, since our course are very liberal, our admission fee, tuition fee, hostel fee is very cheap. So we have been attracting good number of students from our neighboring country, Myanmar. So this way, in this way, we are also encouraging education tourism. Apart from this, in Northeast region, we are organizing fair sense festival. So for example, in Manipur, every year, during the month of November, for 15 days, our government, Manipur government, organized a Sangai festival. It is a festival which is being organized every year to promote tourism in India. Though festival is being organized in Manipur, Imphal, but tourists who come here, they go to other parts of Northeast India and even to our main country, India also. Here in Sangai Festival, which is a festival for promotion of tourism, we exhibit, we show our culture, our dance, our religion, our food habit, our taste, our dress, and many other things. So when tourists come here, they are highly attracted and they used to visit every year. And when they come here, they know about our religion, our culture, our dress, our various things which are available in Northeast region. And they are attracted, and this Pearson Festival are also promoting tourism in Northeast region. Now coming to the main agenda of discussion, that is impact of lockdown, COVID-19. Yes, as we know that this tourism industry is the most affected industry because of lockdown. Tourists used to come by plane, by train. They used to stay in hotel, but because of lockdown, flights are canceled. Trains were canceled. Now only they have been started running. And even they are not allowed to stay in hotel, even nowadays also. Many hotel in Northeast region, including Manipur, including Imphal and Guwahati, have been converted as a quarantine center. So during lockdown, hotels were empty. Tourists were not allowed to come. So the entrepreneur, the industrialist, the owner, who have been running these hotels are suffering a great loss. The employees who have been working in hotels in different capacity are not getting job. For the first 1 or 1.5 months, the hotelier, the owner gave them salary. But since hotels are closed now, they are not earning any income. Therefore, hotel owner have also stopped giving salary to the employees who have been working in these hotels in Northeastern region. Since large number of people were depending on hotel industry as an employee, so they have now become unemployed. So this is a great problem. This is a very, very important impact of lockdown to the hotel industry. Apart from this employee, tourist guide, who used to guide tourists, are also not getting job because tourists are not coming. Therefore, there is no work for tourist guide. So they are remain unemployed. And also, many tourist taxi operator in capital city, in other city also, there are large number of tourist taxi operator. Since because of lockdown, tourists have stopped coming. So this tourist taxi operator driver, they have also become unemployed. This is another great problem, great negative impact of lockdown in this region. Then we all know that when tourists visit a place, they generally buy goods of that very place. So when tourists come to Manipur, tourists come to Guwahati and other place, they do buy the local product, like for example, the goods which are being produced in handloom industry, in handicraft industry. They are also not getting the product because they are unable to sell their product. Entrepreneurs have produced goods. They have invested huge amount of money in producing those goods, which were produced to sell the tourists. Since tourists have stopped coming, therefore entrepreneurs' investment is not giving any return. So it is a great loss to the local entrepreneur, particularly those micro and small entrepreneurs who were producing different varieties of product for selling to the tourists who visit this state. Apart from the entrepreneur, they have employed large number of employees in producing these goods. So they have also remained unemployed. So this COVID-19 lockdown has affected tourism industry. I will say that tourism industry is the maximum affected industry because of this COVID-19 lockdown. So I would like to suggest that later on, when lockdown will be over, when normalcy will restore, then the government should give some concession and facilities, some incentives, subsidies to promote this hotel industry because they have been suffering losses for the last 3.5 months. So they should be encouraged, they should be provided some incentives, some loan at a very, very reasonable rate or interest-free rate so that they can be developed. And apart from this, Northeast India, particularly Manipur, is gateway to the Southeast Asian country. Moray is a town which is located in the Indo-Myanmar border trade. A lot of Myanmarese goods were coming and a lot of Indian goods we are selling to Southeast Asian country. But because of the lockdown, that Moray town is closed. Therefore, we are unable to sell. So as soon as lockdown is over, this trade center, which are located like Moray in Manipur, Dauki in Meghalaya, which is the only road link from Meghalaya to Bangladesh, where large quantity of coal mines and limestone are being exported to Bangladesh, should be open as early as possible, and people should be allowed to go. Then another suggestion which I like to give for promotion of tourism after this lockdown is over is that some state like Mizoram, even Manipur also, Arunachal Pradesh also, Nagaland also, they impose, they ask for inner line permit. So actually this is not encouraging to the tourism industry, because people have to face many problems in getting inner line permit system. So for tourists, since they are coming for few days only, they are not going to settle down here. They will come as a guest. They will stay for few days. So they may be allowed to come without this inner line permit system also. This will certainly promote tourism industry in this backward northeastern region of India. With this, I would like to conclude my presentation. I thank all of you again, particularly I thank Mizoram University and Sikkim University for giving me this opportunity. Thank you and good namaskar. No sound.
Including health sector, education and various areas of tourism you have already covered, and the impacts of the tourism in the public as well as those who are helping taxi drivers, tourism security, tourism courts and various areas. And this we can hope that COVID-19 problem will solve as early as possible, and the opportunities of tourism development in the northeastern region may resume as early as possible. And sir, there are some because of time, I'm just telling something regarding your, there are some questions and that will be sent sir to you, and later on we will communicate sir. And
yeah,
three presentations, and we have to give some time for the presenters. So, okay. So I thank you sir,
okay,
on behalf of the organizing coordinator also, and from the department and all, for the nice presentation sir.
Okay.
So sir, next presenter will be Madam Rama Ramaswamy.
Okay.
He will be presenting on the fostering Atma Bihar Bharat through skill education during COVID-19, a case study of Mizoram University.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor Okindra Singh.
Sir.
My greetings to Professor Prasen.
Yeah.
And all of them who are part of this session. I would like to directly go to my topic because it's limited. We all know that the handlooms constitute a timeless facet of the rich cultural heritage of India. I will be sharing my slide just to give you an overview of handlooms. Are you able to see it, Professor Okindra? Are my slides visible?
Yeah, visible. No. The slide is not visible, madam.
It's not visible.
Please, showing.
Let me just go to it. Please bear with me. Is it visible now, Rokendra?
Yeah, visible. Madam, try to complete in 5-6 minutes. 5 minutes.
Yeah, surely. Actually, I have put in the slides only to show the pictures of the handloom. Okay. So, as he said, there is a lot of talk about Atmanirbhar Bharat. And we, as our Honorable Vice Chancellor mentioned in the morning, I'm also the coordinator of the BVOC handloom Viva course. It is a unique course in India and perhaps the world. None of the universities have a full-fledged degree course in handloom weaving. So I wonder why we have neglected this particular sector, because if you look at the sector, after agriculture, not only it represents the age-old rich cultural heritage of the country, it is the second most important in view of the size and of its size and the employment potential. Most importantly, if we look at the Northeast has the largest concentration of handlooms in the country. More than 65% of the total handlooms of the country are in our region. And It has 50% of the entire handloom force of the country. Assam has the largest number of looms, followed by Manipur, Tripura, Nagaland, Arunachal, and then comes Mizoram because the size is very small. Now, I see a number of young faculty members here. Maybe they will be pursuing research. So let me just give you a historical background of how this course was developed by me. It is an outcome of the research I did way back in 2008 for my PhD. But this one table, we always do, but the first chapter is invariably the socioeconomic profile of our respondents. Now this caught me. When I saw this table, I realized that of my handloom entrepreneurs, 157 had only school education. When I probed further, I realized that all of my respondents are women, dropped out of school after class 8. And these girls had learned weaving from a young age from their mother. The transmission of knowledge is from mother to daughter in the Northeast. And after class 8, when they become very proficient in weaving, they quit education and they get involved in full-time weaving. So at that time itself, I realized there is something that we have to do to bring them into the ambit of education. And after a lot of work, it has taken me almost 13 years in Mizoram University. And at the ground level, I worked with weavers in Thengzol, a handloom cluster in Chershit district. And this course is an outcome of the research work. I realized there are many, many areas where you need to develop them. And this is the first of its kind, as I told you, in the world perhaps. And this curriculum is designed to give an overall training to the student on weaving, entrepreneurship, management, etc., where they were not well versed. So this is one unique case where the skill is there, but the other complementary skills of marketing, entrepreneurship, management were absent. I started this course with 19 students. We have faced a lot of challenges, but we overcome those challenges. And we just completed the practical exams on 13th of March, just before the lockdown was imposed all over India and in Mizoram. And at this time, I realized all my students went back. All of them, most of them are weavers. Some of them are from Thengzol. I would say many of them are from Thengzol. And when I started contacting them, they said that, "Madam, we are weaving our puans." Puans are the traditional cloth, the traditional wraparounds used by the used in the Mizo society by the Mizo women, just like the fanik in Manipur. But they said we are not having market for our puans anymore. So they were facing huge livelihood issues. Then I decided, as a department, that we should facilitate them. You should understand that the entire supply chain was disrupted. The yarn was not available, the looms were idle, livelihood was being affected, no markets. So we as a department facilitated the supply of cotton yarn, pure cotton yarn from NHDC. Mizos usually use acrylic yarn. And we took the help of the Weaver Service Center. The assistant director helped us a lot. We did a lot of quality control there. This raw material was transported to Thengzol through sumos. The students weaved the puans there. And because it's a skill development course, the BWOC, we also have, fortunately, students who have completed their class 11 and 12 in the vocational trade of apparel and garment designing. So these students said, "Ma'am, we will stitch the mask." And so that is how they complemented each other. Some of the students weaving in Thengzol, the cloth was, puan was transported to Aizawl through sumos, and the stitching went on. We also facilitated, they've all been registered in the government e-marketplace. That is also something that we did. So all of them are now entrepreneurs in their own right, registered. Of course, it was not easy being in the Northeast. They did not have a PAN card. The PAN and Aadhaar was not linked. So it was a complete process of learning. And all this we have also taught in our skill development course. Digital India initiatives have been taught. So they started and then we posted the advertisement on the Mizoram University website, Twitter, Instagram. And at the time of this writing, this presenting to you, we've had a huge order of pure handloom cotton mask. Now, again, I should say that, you know, as an entrepreneur, the challenges are never ending. And last some 15 days back, because of the people who returned to Mizoram, there was a spike in the cases and there was a complete lockdown. So then again, we had a problem. How do we transport the puans from Thainzol to Aizol? And then I told them, let us use the India Post. The India Post, Government of India, is the most efficient means of transport. And you won't believe it, it has been a huge success. They go to the sub-post office in Thainzol after they have woven their puans. And then they ask them, because Mizos are very, very informal, very helpful. Their community network is very good. The post man would say, tomorrow the van will go to Aizol. So today the van has reached Aizol and another two puans have come. So, and today my weaver students, I would say, who were laborers, who would, who were manufacturing their puans only to, and they were at the mercy of the master weaver. Today, if you ask my students, they say, we don't want to be working for master weavers anymore. We want to sell directly to the customer because the profits are huge. So I heard, I have seen the messages of Mr. Anurag Kumar, who was saying that we need to be boycotting the Chinese goods. It's possible. It's possible at your own level if we are innovative. Because for every entrepreneur, change is a challenge. And if you can overcome that challenge, for us, the impact of COVID has been very positive because we have made successful entrepreneurs of our students. It's another thing to teach theory in the classroom, and it's a completely different ballgame to make them entrepreneurs in their own right. Now, these are the masks which have been woven by them. I want to show you the pictures. This is the advertisement that we have posted in our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. All these models are my students themselves. Okay, and let me show you the plight of the weavers in Thainzol. It should be the same everywhere in the country, I'm sure. This is typically a loom. This is my student's mother who is weaving. Look at the place in which they are weaving. The charka is there in the kitchen. This is how they weave. As a child, they train with their mother. Thank you very much. And any questions that you would ask, I would be very happy to answer.
Okay, madam, we will share the questions in your email.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
So we'll start the next presenter. Is the Dr. Abhijit Sinha is there? Dr. Abhijit Sinha. I didn't see. So we'll go for the next, Dr. Mabuni Saik. If Dr. Abhijit Sinha is not here, please. Is Dr. Abhijit Sinha here? Okay. So Dr. Mabuni Saik.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So
shall I start, sir?
Yeah. You can start now. Are you?
Okay.
Dr. Mabuni Saik will be presenting on the impact of COVID-19 on Indian economy, government measures to aid businesses during COVID-19.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please complete in 5 minutes.
Okay, sir. Definitely, sir. So, Professor P. Subbarao, sir, Professor Shrotriya Garu, Ganga Prasad Garu, Dr. B. Ramesh, Bharten Singh Garu, Shankar sir, KRS Sambasivrav Garu, Shivram Prasad sir, and BK Suryaprakash Rao sir, a very good afternoon to you all, and other panelists and all attendees, good afternoon to you all also. Now I'm sharing my presentation here. Downloads long.
Can't see. It's coming. Yeah. Yeah, it's coming.
Yes, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Visible.
No. Yeah. Title of my paper is "Impact of COVID-19 on Indian Economy: Government Measures to Aid Businesses During COVID-19." When coming to the introduction part. What all the speakers, earlier speakers mentioned, as it is the same, India is an important trading partner with many countries across the world. Although running a trade deficit, the gap between the country's imports and exports has steadily declining in recent months during the COVID-19. And during this financial year 2020, India's exports contracted 4.8%, while imports decreased to 9.1%, and there is a trade deficit of $152.9 billion. When coming to objectives of my study, I had done this study with four objectives. In this paper, we made an attempt to look at the impact of COVID-19 lockdown on various industries at global level, and to understand the crisis impact on retailers' supply chain in different angles, to study the impact of COVID-19 on Indian economy, and also to find out various measures that are taken by Government of India to aid businesses during this lockdown time period. As the impact of COVID-19 on various industries at global level, I had mentioned so many industries. Due to time limitation in PPT, I had given only four industries, the impact: travel industry. So here, the various travel restrictions cost the tourism industry alone a loss of over $200 billion globally, excluding other loss of revenue for tourism travel, and were forecast to cost the aviation industry a total loss of $113 billion according to IATA. When coming to the impact on financial markets, include the COVID-19 crisis on financial market was the effect in the global stock market. Global stock markets lost $6 trillion in value over 6 days from 23rd February to 28th February. And according to S&P Dow Jones indices, between February 22 to March 19, the S&P 500 index fell by 28%, the FTSE 250 index fell by 41.3%, and the Nikkei fell by 29%. That is the impact of what we observed on the financial markets during the COVID-19 lockdown. When coming to the educational sector, the COVID disrupted $600 billion higher education industry. Educators and students around the world felt the ripple effect of COVID as colleges and universities were instructed to shut down after the COVID was declared a public health emergency in many countries. When coming to the banking sector, the macroeconomic slowdown led to a rise in non-performing loans in the banking sector by 250 basis points. Private sector banks had the highest exposure to credit risk during the outbreak. Apart from these four, I also mentioned in our paper hospitality industry, entertainment sector, health sector, and oil dependent countries also, but I didn't mention in the PPT. Next objective, what we had here clearly, that is impact of COVID-19 on Indian economy. The impact has been felt across various industries, especially pharmaceuticals, auto components, and electronics, which are facing business disruption and the price volatility issues. Sectors like tourism, aviation, hospitality, and the trade have also faced the burnt and the severe travel assembly. The various government measures, what are the various measures that government has been taken, the various initiatives during this lockdown period include the Atmanirbhar, the government has started taking some steps to keep the MSME segment afloat. The RBI recently introduced long-term repo operations worth of 1 lakh crores to help banks increase lending at cheaper interest rates. Government-run banks are also being encouraged to keep loans worth of 60,000 crores. Further announcements made by Nirmala Sitharaman on concluded the relief measures undertaken in 5 tranches by the government as part of the economic package announced by PM Modi for Atmanirbhar Bharat. This table will reflect the various parts of 5 tranches of Atmanirbhar and its corresponding packages, which are giving a grand total of 20,97,053 crores. And here I mentioned separately the different measures that has been taken by Government of India towards various sectors, or that is towards banks, that is the cheaper cash, loan freeze, and measures taken towards regulatory deferrals. Banks' activity through stable sources have been deferred October 1 to from April 1st. Measures taken towards higher provisions. Banks has taken higher provisions of 10% on all frozen loans spread over the January, March, and April, June quarters. Measures taken towards dividends halted. Bank can't pay dividend for the year ended March 31st to conserve capital. Decisions will be reviewed on the basis of their financial position on September 30. And the other measures towards sovereign bonds include more money, inviting foreigners, limited borrowing, more dollars, shorter trading hours, etc. And other measures taken towards states and wider economy include exports, crops, lockdown eased. And measures towards consumers include free food and fuel, cash transfers, insurance, jobs, and wages. So all these elaborately we mentioned in the paper. And when coming to the conclusion, with COVID-19 spreading quickly in India, policymakers are worried about how to fight the virus and minimize its impact on the economy. In addition to containing the spread of the disease and support those who are affected, policymakers have to be prepared for the long-term challenges and opportunities that may arise once the crisis is over. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I thank all the organizers and speakers of this webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. You have presented. We are thankful to you. You have presented a very
thank you, sir.
A nice presentation about the situation and government measures to handle the situation. So now I want to hand over to Professor Prasine to give as a chairman some concluding views about the session. This.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Rukendra. This was a very interesting session, and as I have told and other.
Yeah, some problem. So now I hand over to our ICOT and coordinator, Professor Bartendu Singh.
Thank you, Professor Rokendru. And thank you, Professor Prasin, for your time. Now we are proceeding towards the third session. Third session is going to be chaired by Professor B. Ramesh. And this session will be coordinated by my young colleague, Dr. Lalnait Luangi Fanai. She is here with me. She is an assistant professor in our department. So she will be taking over from here. One thing I will like to say about Professor B. Ramesh. He has worked in Mizoram long back in 1993. Sir must be remembering this. So with this, I will give handover to my colleague, Manai.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, Ramesh.
Good afternoon.
Ramesh,
good afternoon. Okay.
Good afternoon, Ramesh.
Good afternoon, everyone. Here we shall start technical session 3. Here we are going to have the 4 speaker today. I hope we can have a nice time today. And here, first of all, I will call Professor B. Ramesh. He is a professor in commerce, Goa Business School. I just want to give a brief introduction about him. He has been in the teaching profession of the last 36 years, and like he has worked in different colleges and the universities, and he has a lot of experience, and he has published more than 85 papers in various reputed journals, and like he has chaired technical session more than 19 national and international conference and seminars. Here we know that like he has a lot of experience, and we are very fortunate to have him here. And right now I shall call upon him, so Professor B. Ramesh, to deliver the keynote right now. So sir, please, can you hear me? You can.
Yes.
You can start right now. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. I hope I'm audible to all of you. Hello, I'm audible to all of you. Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Good afternoon to everyone, and I'm really excited to join this webinar. I've joined many webinars so far, but then this is a more special webinar for me by virtue of my relationship with Mizoram University, and of course at that time it was not Mizoram University when I worked in Aizen. It was only Nehru campus. So I was in Nehru campus. Subsequent to my departure from there, it became a university, and then later on Central University. But then my roots and the starting point of my career, and if today if I'm in Goa University with 6 years of teaching experience with my background, and the footing they took was only from Mizoram University. So therefore, so all the reasons for my excitement today for joining the webinar, which is conducted by Mizoram University jointly with Sikkim University. So I need to congratulate organizers, Bhartendru, as well as Gauri from Sikkim University for giving me the opportunity to join this webinar. And as I see here, there are 3 speakers in my session in the area of banking and of capital market area, financial markets. And in this context, I need to bring in that I would confine my presentation for about 15 to 18 minutes, and then give the time slot for others, and then come back to the question and answer session. And I'm not going to bombard with my PPT. So without the theoretical PPT, I only wanted to show in terms of the market trends that has happened when we are talking about the impact on the capital market in India, especially the stock market. We need to understand what are the factors that would determine the fate of the economy. And I would consider that Indian economics is an important aspect in terms of what finally determines when we joined in the bandwagon of the global economy. And India is not in isolation. India is in the bandwagon of the world economy. And we all are aware of it for the last 20 years. So whatever happens world over, and we are also part of it in terms of either fortunes that we derive or in terms of misfortunes that we derive by being the participant in the world globally. So this is the moot point that you need to understand when we are talking about the impact of COVID and its impact on the financial market. So with this trailer, I would like to tell very clearly that it is more than 200 countries which have been affected by this COVID, and affected not necessarily in terms of the life of the people, but also in terms of the effect on the economic backbone of all these countries. So India is not an exception. The only point of difference is only what is the extent of impact on each country is only a matter of discussion for us. So we are in the context of discussing what is the impact of this kind of COVID on Indian economy and then Indian financial state. And now, with this, again, I try to refer, being part of our role in the global economy, whatever the macro factors that we see in terms of the influence on the growth of our own country in terms of economic factors, so we need to relook at them. Now, to be very susceptible, since the time is short, now I'll come back directly into the point without going around. And the factors that affect the Indian economy, what we have seen ever since the reforms have been initiated, not necessarily economic reforms, but also reforms in terms of the market reforms, in terms of regulatory reforms, in terms of the policy reforms at the government level, and in terms of the reforms of doing business, ease of doing business in India. So these are all the backdrop of the form. So it is in terms of that, I would say that we need to keep in mind that what is driving the Indian economy is in terms of our own trade deficit, which you understand the difference between exports and imports, and the resulting figure in terms of our foreign exchange reserves. Now I want to draw a point of reference here. There is in, with all this kind of COVID impact, the 2 days back, we have got the reports that the forex reserves have touched $500 billion in India. So that is only a kind of consolation for us during this period. And how we have touched that point is a different point of discussion. Perhaps could be only the two reasons for that. And one reason is that our import oil bill has considerably gone down, which is a history in the Indian economy till now. And because of the lockdown and the demand for the oil products in India has come down, and the oil prices which are rising, what we have witnessed during the last 9 days, is altogether a different discussion, because the reasons for oil, retail oil price, is something because of the policies of the government in terms of the taxation. But otherwise, the government of India has saved huge amount of savings in terms of the cuts in the import oil bills. That is one reason why we could save our foreign exchange reserves, which we used to otherwise spend earlier. So that was one reason for bulging foreign exchange reserve. And the second one is that despite all these factors, India is still considered to be a favorite destination for foreign direct investments. Keeping in mind various factors, not necessarily economic factors, but various other factors. So therefore, these are the two factors that have contributed to our 500 billion foreign exchange reserves, as we have seen the last, not in this way, as reported. And now the other factor that we need to keep in mind, what drives the Indian economy, apart from this foreign exchange reserve, is our GDP. Now this is somewhere we have to mind our business in terms of the reality. And the reality is that the GDP has been on the sliding side now, which is, when I see the reports today, the Fitch reports, that it is going to be on the minus side, which is very alarming. And that's but natural, because when the whole industry is kept under law, the economic factors and the serious consideration for lifting off the lockdown by the government of India, which is already announced that we are no more going to have the lockdown. It's only because of this serious concern for the economic impact of this lockdown, which we cannot afford. I'm sure all of you would remember when Trump made in the month of April his statement, not April, first week of April specifically, that we cannot afford to have the lockdown in US economy. And then of course they have paid the price. It is a question of the timing to adopt. When it is necessary, you need to follow that. But then once you cross that limit, there's no point of continuing with the same kind of policies that yes, you continue to be the lockdown. So now the India and the Indian government, the policymakers have come to the conclusion that we are going to close this lockdown because the economic loss to the country is going to be unprecedented compared to the kind of prevention of the loss of lives that we can afford to do it through lockdown. So therefore, it is a kind of trade-off, I repeat the word trade-off, between the loss of prevention of the loss of lives. And if you cannot prevent the loss of lives, then we should start learning to live with the kind of epidemic. So that's the meaning. It is not that human lives are less valuable than the economic value of the country or the economic values of the people. But the point here is that when we cannot prevent through the lockdown, at the same time we are incurring the economic loss, so we cannot afford to continue with this kind of thing. So that is the kind of principle that is adopted by the government of India. And I'm sure that you're going to have this announcement by the Prime Minister very soon in this context. And the third aspect that governs the impact of our financial market is the FDI investments. FII, I'm talking about foreign institutional investors. And also because of the stock markets are predominantly governed by these two factors. Apart from the influences from the demand side of the domestic market, the demand side of the stock market is essentially from the FIIs. So one cannot rule out the impact of the FIIs. Now I'm going to share slides of this just to show you a snapshot of what is the impact of that. And the next important factor is in terms of the interest rate. And if you look at the interest rate that have happened during the last 1 year, and I have the data which I'm going to show you. Last 1 year, the interest rate till the end of Feb were little higher. And it is from the March onward, the interest rates are sliding down. With interest rate, bank interest rates, which I'm talking. So when interest rates are sliding down, it's essentially because there is the fact that the government, RBI announces the cuts in the interest rate base points. So the fact that we get to understand is that there's no demand for the funds. And that's the reason why the interest rates are cut. But all day despite cuts in the interest rates, if still the demand is not created from the industry for various reasons, so then obviously we are going to face the situation. So that is another factor. And then the repo rates, which is an important factor. The repo rate is an indicator of impact of not necessarily COVID, but by any of the factors. The repo rate, if you see, I have analyzed for the last 1 year, and last 9 months prior to Feb, the interest rates are very high and repo interest rates are high. And now later on, they get sliding down. So now, since I got the bell, so let me ask you, please share my slides, which I can go through. Well, I can't share it because of some reason. So, but can you please, I have already shared my slides. Can you please open up my slides?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Now, please open up my slides.
The slide.
Yes, sir, you may start now.
Yeah. Now, these are the general factors what I have already briefed up. Now I'm showing you the data. So there's nothing to explain except the points that you need to understand. Yeah, the FDI investments, if you see from June 2019 till April 20. The impact that you see is because the COVID impact, what we have seen is only in terms of the first quarter of 2020. But then during the last almost 9 months, the FDI investment was seen peak in the month of June, subsequently lower level. And then it fell down, but then in January, it again picked up. December, January, it picked up. And it is not that bad in the month of Feb and March. But then the impact is seen in terms of April. Yeah, next slide. In terms of FIIs, next slide. Foreign portfolio investment. These are the people. And this is a graphical picture which I'm trying to show during the same period. But as I said, the Indian stock markets are essentially driven by these FDI indirectly on the stock market, FII directly on the stock market, foreign portfolio investment. On monthly basis, I've given you the graph which shows that we have seen much of the impact only in the later part of the year. But then this cannot be, I don't have time to explain the reasons for the swings during the intra-month period of 19 and 20. But then the impact of what we would see at the end of the March 2000 or April 2020 is phenomenal, especially March, April. Next slide. Next slide. And I'm sure, you have jumped from repo to interest rates. Interest rates, this is one thing, what you have seen, the peak in the month of August 2019 was 5.75. And now imagine in the month of May 2020, it is 4.4. And now in the month of June, it is again 4.2 points basis. So this indicates that the finance is available at cheaper rate. And that indicates that lack of demand for the finance. And lack of demand finance in the sense lack of industrial activity. So this is an indicator, bad indicator for the economic growth of the country. Next slide. Next slide.
Is it correct?
No, GDP growth. Yeah, that's okay, fine, no problem. GDP.
Next
one. The slide which you showed earlier, GDP. Now you need to move forward.
Next.
You are coming to the last. You need to move up. Okay, GDP.
You should go backward.
Yeah, GDP growth, all of you are aware of it, that now it is the big question mark, as we see, and today we got a very shocking news, as I have already mentioned, the Fitch has given, that the GDP is going to be the minus figure. And if you look, I have a data of GDP over a period of 20 years. And the maximum in Indian economy, the maximum GDP rate was 9.8. And now the lowest point till now, before the COVID, was 4.5. And now, according to the Fitch report, which is released today, it's going to be as predicted as negative of GDP growth, which is going to be a very alarming situation. And now, in terms of the impact of COVID, and I have not taken this kind of Sensex Nifty returns only to show you, because it's not the question of data, but in terms of understanding the movement and the kind of bottom up as well as the bottom line. You can understand. And the aberration, what you see here in the month of March, it is very staggering. And both Sensex returns as well as Nifty returns have really violated the norms of the demand and supply. So therefore, now it is only a question of stabilization, what we have seen during the later part of the May and June. And now June, yes, the markets are moving. And I have been following talk with other people, that is more of the sentiments that are driven in terms of the market functioning. The next slide. Next slide.
That's all, sir.
No, one more slide is in terms of. Yes. Market capitalization. Previous one. Previous. Market capitalization. Okay, and the benchmark for any kind of economy is the market capitalization. So the stock market index of either Sensex or 100 BSE or 200 BSE or Nifty 50 or Nifty 100. The benchmark index is based upon this kind of market capitalization. So you need to understand what is the extent of the influence on market capitalization. And it has grown to such an extent that almost 100% depreciation was recorded. But then because of the COVID during these 3 months, the market capitalization is slugging in terms of its depreciation. And now let me talk the future vision in one or two sentences. These are all the statistics that we need to understand in terms of what is the impact of it. But then what lies ahead? And I can foresee that what are the industries that are driving these market forces are essentially the drivers of pharma industry, technology industries, because these are going to be the future industries. And you can see the extent of the investment that has, this is the only company in India which has attracted so much of foreign participation, FDI participation in this company, which no other company in India has done that, which belongs to this telecom industry. So therefore, we have the bright future for the telecom industry, technological. At some point of time earlier, we said that the infotech companies are going to be back. But now you would see the resurgence of the infotech companies, the electronic companies, and also the telecom companies, the pharma companies, health sector. So what is the extent of these companies that they get into the business and then scale up their operations? It all depends upon the boosting of the financial markets. Now the point of reference, how long it would take for recovery, is only a question mark that we need to answer only on the basis of how fast we control this kind of academic situation. So that, I'm back to you and to the people. So the organizer, you may invite the speakers. I understand there are three speakers in my session.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. It is very informative, and you have presented very well the impact of COVID-19 during and post-COVID scenario on Indian capital market. Right now, we shall go to the next speaker. May I invite Professor B.K. Surya Prakasa Rao. He is the head professor and head Department of Management Sciences, RBR at JC College of Engineering, Guntur, and then he will talk about the impact of COVID-19 on stock market, a study of Brixar. We'll give you 5 minutes, and please try to complete within 5 minutes, and so we can call the next speaker. So right now, the time is yours, sir. You may start.
So please unmute.
Hello, sir. It's still unmuted. Sir, please unmute your screen, please. Unmute.
Okay. Yes. Are you listening, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. Respected Professor K.R. Samsara, Vice Chancellor of Mizoram University, Professor Subba Rao, Professor Shotya, Professor Ganga Prasad, Professor Jyoti Kumar, Professor Ramesh, the second chairman of this today's session of afternoon. Good afternoon, everybody. Our presentation on the impact of COVID-19 on stock markets, a study of BRICS, is a joint paper written by myself and my colleagues, Dr. Manjusha and Dr. Aribabu. Sir. Okay.
Sir, please.
Yes. Madam. Yes, my paper is on the impact of COVID on stock markets, specifically in BRICS nations. BRICS nations are Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Yes, all these industrialized developing countries are formed together, but it is into the first only BRIC, BRIC, Brazil, Russia, India, China was formed in the year 2006 as a group. And after 2010 only, the other country was invited to this group as South Africa. Now it is the name coined as BRICS is undefined. Yes, BRICS economies are severely influencing globally developed economies, especially low-income countries in the world. On 31st December 2019, the World Health Organization identified the first case of COVID-19 in China, Wuhan. In early and mid-January 2020, the virus started to spread all over the Chinese provinces, supported by a huge movement of people towards their hometowns to celebrate their Chinese New Year celebrations, which turned the outbreak into a national crisis. Although Wuhan officials announced a complete travel ban in terms of its residents on January 23rd, the virus still spread quickly to all over the world. The WHO declared global emergency due to the rapidly spreading of the coronavirus COVID-19 on January 30th, 2020. It's the only sixth time that such type of global emergency has been declared by WHO since 1948, only six times out of 72 years of their existence in the world. Yes, sir. Next I will go for using the data is available. Five countries. What are the definitions of the country's stock indexes and abbreviation country-wise? I'll show the diagram. The next slide I will go for giving that. Yes, what happened here? The data is identified here as I get the data from all these five countries' stock markets data with their indexes. On January 3rd, I think most of the indexes of these five countries are on the peak. On January 3rd, Brazil have 93,002.14 as index. Russia is 3,086.09. India is 41,464.61. China is 3,092.59. But after the seriousness of COVID-19, by 22nd March, I can take data. That is the post-COVID means after 22nd March, and the abnormal impact on the stock markets all over the world. I take the data January 3rd of 2020, and again, the second slot would happen, the 22nd March 2020 are taken. The change of indexes of all five countries on average 24.88% except China. Please remember that is the Brazil is declined by 21.5, Russia declined by 22.19, India 27.85, that is South Africa 28.43. But whereas China's decline rate is only 10.36%. This is identified. And after looking this data happen, the entire world is looking China as a sin because they did something intentionally. They did something wrong in the world markets and demand. That is why their markets down by only 10%. All other countries on average 24.88% is a demand. After 22nd March, I get data from as that is. 7th of June, I will take the data. 7th of June, that means total after 22nd March, 11 weeks data I compared. That means what happened over using after that is 11 weeks of 22nd March would happen, the stock market is slowly moving up. That is what happened. That is Brazil increased the market from 22nd March to January, June 7th, 28.95%. Then go back, Russia is only 14.27%. India is 12.92%. China is only 5.2%. Because the decline rate is also 50%, less than 50% of an average of all other countries. South Africa increased by 23.38%. These are the data what I don't have. The average of all four countries except China have been declined by 24.88%. And the China index is only 10.36%. During the last 11 weeks period, all BRIC nations indices are on the upside moving. Between 5.32% by China and the highest increase in that is Brazil by 28.95%. And that's all. Okay. Next, I will go for the methodology. What I did here. The objectives of my study, to study the fluctuation in the stock markets of BRICS nations in the post-COVID-19. To investigate the impact of the COVID-19 on the stock markets of BRICS nations with appropriate research tools and data. Methodology, what I used here, the total data was collected from the secondary sources. That is, all the exchanges data I draw from 22nd March 2020 to 10th June 2022, the data is collected. The tools are identified here. That is, as a correlation discrepancies regression analysis, ANOVA test was conducted. That is, the data is identified like this. Just a minute. Yes, this is the data. Stock market weak returns of BRIC nations from 29th March. Why I am 29th March here? The weekend from 22nd March to 29th is the weekend is undefined. 29th March to that 10th of that is the last day is 7th of June. I take the data is undefined. This data also plotted on the bar diagrams. Please observe this data. In that bar diagram, the line diagram, what happened? The Chinese market is identified as you go for using as this data, what happened? It is more or less flat. There are more or less flat is undefined. But the all other four countries' data happened abnormally fluctuated because of the sensitivity of the markets other than China is very, very high. The sensitivity about the Chinese market is very, very small and also insignificant when compared to the other all five markets are undefined. Yes, sir. The stock markets data identify using the weaknesses of the data what I will go for using as you identify then for all BRIC nations there was a continuous fluctuation in the returns from 22nd March 2010 to 2020 to 10th June 2020. For Brazil, that is the highest is 11.71 and the lowest is 5.3. That is a minus value. And Russia is the highest is 7.13, lowest is minus 5.34. Then you go for India is identifying as on the highest 12th April is 12.93 and the lowest is minus 6.15% in 10th June, 10th May 2020. For China, it was high in 31st May 2020 as 2.75, lowest is 1.9. Please observe the data what happened. The highest lowest for China is very, very low when compared to the all other four countries as we studied. Then you go for using. The descriptive stats also I presented here. That is the things are undefined. Yes, that is identified. You know, the table on descriptive analysis, mean, standard deviation, mediation, median, standard deviation, sample variance, range, minimum, maximum, and all these things are shown as data is undefined. Yes,
sir. Sorry for little interruption. Please try to complete within 1 minute and then.
Okay, madam. Okay. Just I will go for concluding session. So the analysis I conducted here, considering the F test, the critical value table, value of F, we can say that null hypothesis can be rejected and hence we accept the alternative hypothesis. That is H1 is accepted. That is the Indian stock market returns are influenced significantly by the returns of other four economies. That is Brazil, Russia, China and South Africa. That is market index was influenced the Indian stock market reform. The regression equation using the intercepts of regression output as follows. BS Sensex is equal to 1.6498 plus of all these other four countries are defined. That is identified as you go for it. The mean of South Asia, that is, and the entire coefficient are positive and Russia had the highest impact on the stock markets of India is undefined. India and Russia is the very, very positive correlation between these two countries when compared to the other countries.
Okay.
Just a minute.
Okay.
Yes. Why are you concluding this data? What happened to be using the correlation? The BRICS countries are one of the fastest growing economies of the world. The present study, which examined the stock margins of major stock indices of these five economies, has found similar in the stock margins of these countries, except small. The insignificant deviation with the China is undergone. The studies undertaken to investigate the impact of COVID-19 on the stock markets from the period 22nd to June 10th is undergone. The correlation among the five economies is positive except between Russia and China and India. Brazil with India, South Africa with India is identifying as regression model as a positive correlation difference. The BRIC economies have immense potential to remain powerful and influence the world economies as and when till the BRICS only is a forum and not an organization. This study has revealed that there is a positive significant relationship between the COVID-19 and all the stock markets of BRIC nations. That means the COVID had a significant impact on the stock markets during the study period. If BRICS nations form either a free trade zone or customs union, that the trade can be increased manifold and a stronger force can be emerged in the near future as and when they created these things are different. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Undi. Okay.
Thank you. Very informative and excellent presentation. And right now we shall go to the next speaker. So we shall call Nazia S. Mansouri. He is Assistant Professor, TS Faculty of Commerce, Hello? Maharaja Sayyed Rao, University of Baroda. And he will Hello? Talk about impact of COVID-19 lockdown on mutual fund investment pattern. Mr. Nazia S. Mansouri, yep, are you online? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Okay, you will have 5 minutes. Please start your you may start your presentation right now. Okay. Where is...
Are you able to see my screen?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone.
Please press F5.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So the slide will be...
And my topic for the presentation is impact of COVID-19 lockdown on the mutual fund investment patterns. This is the flow of my presentation: introduction, literature review, object of the study, discussion and analysis, findings and summary, conclusion, backed up by the
lab. Be louder, please. We cannot hear you properly.
Okay. Introduction. As we all know, the India is a saving-based economy, and we would always like to save something, even if we are earning less or more, right? And this thing are invested in a various investment avenue. One way is we can directly invest, and another is if we are not having enough time, excellence, and knowledge of the particular securities, then we can always give our money to mutual funds, and mutual funds will invest this money, right? So, mutual fund industry is having a very much impact on the economy of the India, and there are so many investors who are investing in a mutual fund. Now, nowadays we know that we all are facing the lockdown situation due to COVID-19, and in this situation, many of us have not received income or have received partial income. So this paper was having a intention to find out in the receipt of less income, what is the impact on investment, and specifically mutual fund investment. So this is a literature review. I'm going to skip this. And the next is object of the study. In this study, I have put an attempt to find out the latest trend in the mutual fund industry. And I wanted to compare the trends of investment in mutual fund pre and post during the COVID-19 lockdown. These are the six parameters which I have gone through to find out the impact of COVID-19 lockdown. I'll discuss one by one. The first one is total assets. excuse me, I am unable to see my screen. Somebody else is sharing the screen.
Hey, Ashok,
okay. So this is, if we see the trend, generally we compare the trend year by year, right? So in case of March,
hello?
2019, it was 24.58 trillion.
Oh, very good. Ashok Garg, sorry.
It was 24.71 trillion. So year to year, there was increase. But lockdown was in March. So we need to check after March. If we see the data after March, see 24.71 in the March, and thereafter 23.53 trillion, and then 24.28 trillion. So there was a downfall as far as the total assets were concerned. Why this was happened? Because of lockdown, people got panic and they started to redeem their investments. And on 24th April, there was a big announcement from Franklin Templeton that they are going to shut down their six major investment schemes, right? So thereafter, people got panic and they were running here and there, and they were redeeming their investment. To stop this and to support the mutual fund industry, on 27th April, RBI announced that they are going to give the liquidity support to mutual fund industry, and they declared a pledge of 50,000 crore to back up this particular industry, and this effect can be seen in the May data. So thereafter, there was some recovery, but yet, yes, there is no full recovery after this announcement also. So mutual fund got affected in very badly in April, and a little bit recovery was in March. And if you see scheme-wise composition, I have compared from May 2019 to May 2020. If we see whatever money available with the mutual fund, 41% is around 41% is invested in equity oriented scheme, and then second preference is given to debt scheme, thereafter liquidity scheme, and last is ETFs and FSOs. If we want to check the lockdown effect, then we will see the data of March, April, and May. You can see that pattern. In case of equity share, it has from 41, it has fallen to 39. In March, usually people sell some of the shares, so that's okay. But if we further go, then they have not recovered. See, in case of April and May 2020, yet there is a downfall. Why this was happened? Because people were panic and they started to sell, and even mutual fund also. They were less preferring investment in the equity fund. They were waiting for the good point or good entry point. If we see the data, then in case of equity share, mutual fund invested only 6363 crore in stock markets in last week of the March, while they pulled out 7965 crores in April. Reversing the trend, selling trend in May, they put in 2823 crore as per the data. And so overall, during the lockdown, they have invested only 1230 crores in the stock market, which is very less as compared to earlier period. Now, as compared to if you are going for debt, in case of debt, see, earlier there was a high trend in the debt, and thereafter, after Templeton, it went off, and there was a fall or decrease in the investment in debt scheme also. In case of debt scheme, if we see credit scheme, so net and outflow of 5373 crores, and the medium duration scheme, debt scheme, that showed the outflow of 1519 crores. So overall there was a panic, and overall there was a reduction in investment. Next is, I have just presented this graphically, it is the same thing. Second parameter, third parameter is composition. If you want to see, in May 2019, the investment proportion in a total mutual fund, what is the proportion of investment done by individual or retail investor, and investment done by institutional corporate. So earlier there was wide difference between the two. In May, 54.90% was from individual, and 45.90% was from institutional investor. But by the end of this period, in May 2020, we can see that almost they are same. 50.70% from individual and 49.30 is from institutional investor. So investment, proportional investment from the individual has gone down, and institutional investment has gone up during this time. If we see the data, then yes, in May, overall money invested by the FIIs are 14,500 crores, right? So this is the situation, that composition of the investment or investor is changed during this time. Now, if you see the proportional share of the investor categories in different types of the scheme, this is of May data, May 2020. In case of equity-oriented scheme, most of the money is received from the individual investor. Out of 100, 87 is received from individual investor and 13 is received from institutional investor. But for other types of scheme, like debt, liquid or money market, and ETFs, most of the money come from institutional investor. So as far as the preference is concerned, individual investors are preferring equity for the investment by and large, and institutional investors are investing in debt, liquidity, and ETFs. And their foremost preference is liquid, because they are waiting, they are thinking that many people may come and may ask for the money. So they are stressing upon the liquidity. Okay. Next is the fifth parameter.
Madam, 2 minutes, please.
Yes.
Within 2 minutes, please try to complete.
Composition of investor holding. If you see the investment pattern of the individual investor, most of the money is invested in equity, that is 67%. Thereafter, their preference is debt. Thereafter, preference is liquid money. And then only 1% investment is in ETF and FX. But institutional investor, their investment pattern is different. As far as institutional investor is concerned, they are investing 42% money in liquid. Then thereafter, debt comes, that is 34%. Thereafter, ETS, and the last preference is equity shares. And I have presented the same thing graphically. It is same, that is showing the equity, and this is showing the liquid fund. Last parameter to be discussed is growth. Total assets, these are in crores, we can write in trillions also. That is 13.76 trillions was in May 2019 for individual, which has fallen to 12.31 trillion. So there is a fall as far as the assets of the individual is concerned. And in case of institutional investor, as I said earlier, there is a rise in the assets put up by the institutional investor. Earlier in May 2019, it was 11.66 around trillion, and here in May 2020, it has rise to 11.97 trillion. And if we compile all the assets, yes, overall there is a fall. It was 25.43, but now it has 24.28 trillion. So overall effect is that in case of mutual fund, there is a fall in the assets. So my findings in summary: total assets of mutual fund have decreased. That is one thing. And nowadays people are not having trust in small scheme or medium scheme. They are having the preference for the large scheme, well established scheme only. Then investment in equity oriented scheme is less by the mutual fund itself. They are still waiting for the good entry points. As far as they will find the good entry points, they will again invest more in equity funds. Right now they are preferring the liquid funds. Then credit-rated funds are also facing the outflow. Medium schemes are also facing the outflow. And share of institutional investor has increased during this period after the lockdown. Conclusion that yes, like any other industry, mutual fund industry has also got affected, and its effect can be seen in the terms of value of the total asset, composition of investor type, and preferences of the scheme. And these are the references. And thank you.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Very nice and a brief presentation. If time is very limited, because of that, we interrupt you in the meantime. So I hope you all understand us. And right now we shall invite the last speaker. That will be Dr. Kaberi Bes Barua. He is Assistant Professor, Department of Accountancy, Guwahati Commerce College. And right now we shall give him time, sir. Hello, Dr. Kaberi.
Yeah.
Oh, hello, madam. Okay. I cannot see your picture before because of that. We call you. Okay, anyway, madam, right now we have time. So within 5 minutes, please try to do your presentation. And so I hope you understand us the time because of the time limitation. Right now, the time is yours. So you may.
Thank you, ma'am. Honorable dignitaries of this conference and respected chairperson of today's session, Professor B. Ramesh, a very good afternoon to everyone. I don't have a PPT presentation because of the time limitation. I hope I can get across my ideas that I have collected through my survey, through my paper. The title of my paper is Trajectory of EMI and COVID-19. A study with special reference to Assam. This was my topic of my paper. What I've tried to find out here is, as we all know, several reports or surveys has shown that India is truly transforming from a saving nation to a borrowing nation. This change in attitude will have a very long time effect on the Indian economy. On the other hand, the Indian market is becoming dynamic, and what the new wave of the market is that all the products and the services are being aggressively sold to the middle class people. And this is only, and this has been fueled by the EMI policy or the EMI method, that is equated monthly installments. Now, what is another trend of this market is that majority of the buyers today in the Indian market, better you say, are the young people. Yes, young consumers. The major chunk of the Indian market are the young consumers, and they are changing the ways the shopping is done and the brands that are selected. And in this very background, I have taken two objectives for my paper, simply two objectives. One is, what is the impact of COVID-19 on the attitude towards EMI by the young generations? And second, just to know the preferences for which they adopt the policy of EMI, or they adopt the method of EMI. A quick survey was done. My total respondents were 121. It was on online survey was made for them. And people from different sectors were selected. Like there are students, there are self-employed respondents, there are salaried persons, and they are salaried from the government and also from the private sectors. Because I wanted to know the approach from these different sectors, whether this COVID-19 has impacted different people in different ways. Now, all of them, my people have agreed why they have resorted to EMI. Now, what is EMI doing to the entire nation is that there is a due to this EMI method or lure of EMI, the monthly savings of the household are decreasing on one hand, and secondly, the household debt is increasing because the products are available by slow payment of EMI, so everyone is resorting to that. Now, when the question was asked to my respondent, why do have they opted for EMI? They say that when you buy a product with the help of EMI, it doesn't burn a hole in your pocket because the money doesn't go out at once. The entire pattern is spread over a period of time, which makes them easy to digest. And secondly, most of my respondents were from urban areas. Why? Well, if you ask me why, because I'm majority from Guwahati. Because if you see Guwahati being the capital of Assam, yes, and here all the brands, whether it's a normal brand or two luxury brand, whether you say it to be an Audi or whether you're wanting an Apple product, everyone has a showroom in here. Yes, so and everyone, all the luxury brands are also offering the concept or offering their products with the help of the EMI. So everyone could get into it. And 67% of my respondents have said that they have resorted to the EMI technique just to fulfill their household family needs. And the major chunk is for on buying a vehicle. It may be a two-wheeler or it may be a four-wheeler. And 33% have responded that they have resorted to EMI policy just to get to upgrade their lifestyle. Yes, they say that when you have a watch, a smartwatch of an Apple, or when you are wearing, when you are carrying a Apple laptop, it creates an influence on the society or the people you are dealing with. Yes, and in this particular background, when all of a sudden when the COVID-19 has struck, the entire economy has come to a standstill. And in Assam, especially, together with this standstill, the economy was already sluggish. We have already a problem of infiltration. We have the problem of insurgency. We have the problem of flood. And added to it, the COVID-19 has struck. Now, the respondents that I've worked with, no one was laid off. But there were some of the people, yes, they were cut in their increments. There was freezing of promotions. Yes, they have suffered that. Now, this has brought them a positive attitude to that. Now, as you well know, if they are, a majority have said that due to the payment of the expenditures every day, they have nothing to save and they don't want to save that because the statement of the private banks as such that they can guarantee only up to 1 lakh of the savings of the people have had a negative effect on the people. Yes? And they say that they don't resort to money back policies only because the money value decreases with time. So if they can enjoy products, if they can go on a vacation with the help of an EMI, they want to enjoy it itself now. So instead of saving, but with the stocking of COVID-19, when the future has become bleak and when it's uncertainty, although most of them have not lost their jobs, but they fear because of the reverse migration. Now people are coming back to the state. So if not now, in future, they may have a fear of job loss because there has been a reverse migration due to this COVID-19. So they are having a second thought that instead of going into conspicuous consumption, 91% of my respondents have agreed that in future, at least they will start saving and not go for a luxury band expenditure in the near future. So that if due to the uncertainty, if they lose a job or if they have to strive through this economic backlog, they may have to save for the future where they did save, but saving was very marginal. So one positive finding that I have found in my entire survey is that people will having a second thought, especially I'm talking about the young ones, I have surveyed only the people below the age of 45. Previously, it was safe Then now, as we know, the 45 years of age, now they're having a thought of starting to save or investment in certain kind of funds so they can have a secure future. Because we know only in the long run, this saving of the people will only help to form the capital formation of the country. So if the people are not saving, the capital formation of the country in the long run will be affected. So as I conclude, I may say that this COVID-19 and this EMI approach of mine have taken a U-turn, because people are saying they'll go less on this EMI policy because it is hampering the savings of the household, and they are going to resort to savings a certain amount of money and not resorting to 100% of the EMI policy. That's all what I want to say. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, madam. Very, very informative presentation. And right now, may I call again Professor B. Ramesh to say concluding remarks? He is still on the line. Hello?
He's there.
Oh, hello? Sir, Professor B. Ramesh? Hello. Okay. Right now, I shall hand over to the organizer. Thank you very much. We can have a nice time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manai, for helping me. Now we are proceeding toward the fourth session. In this fourth session, we are having two resource persons, Sri Dasari Ramakrishna and Professor R. Shivarama Prasad. And in this session, Dr. Gurram Ramakrishna will help me. And he is here. He is a colleague in my department, assistant professor in Department of Commerce. Hello. And I have chosen him for this session because he is a student, a scholar of Professor R. Shivaram Prasad. He has done his MPhil under him. So I especially requested him to be here for the session. So, over to
him. First of all, I would like to thank our head, Professor Bhatendu Singh. So thanks for giving me this opportunity to invite my guide, my mentor, Professor R. Shivaram Prasad sir, for this session. So, two lines about him. Actually, he is a head and dean of the Department of Commerce in Acharya Nagarjuna University, and he published nearly 30 plus research publications and 5 books and 100 plus extension lectures. And because of him, Department of Commerce in Acharya Nagarjuna University has a number of MOUs. His contribution to the department and to the university and to the students and to the scholars and beyond the department, sir contributed and helped so many students as well. I'm very much glad to invite Professor R. Shivaram Prasad sir. Namaste sir. Please continue your lecture, sir. Thank you. Sir, please unmute your mic, sir, please.
Okay. Respected Professor B. Singh, head of the Department of Commerce, Mizoram University. Professor Avinash Ji, the Vice Chancellor of the Sikkim University. Professor K. R. Samsara Garu, Vice Chancellor of the Mizoram Central University, and Professor P. Subbarao Garu, the Vice Chancellor of the Millennium University, and A.N. Shankar, and all the participants were the one-day symposium on the COVID, the new COVID-19, it impact on the trade and commerce and the business. First, I wish to congratulate the Mizoram University Vice Chancellor, Professor K.R. Samsurao Garu. Very, very different way, dynamic way, has conducting number of webinar programs, and simultaneously Sikkim University Vice Chancellor. First, come to the topic. So far, so many speakers maximum emphasized and focused on the different areas. Majority of the people emphasize on the, especially some isms, and the capitalism, communism, socialism, and some of the people touched some of the important points which are related to the economy, how economy is going to affected a lot, what type of the measures we'll take, and some of the speakers very different way touching the marketing aspects, but no one perfectly visualize, predict the future issues of the commerce, trade and industry. My dear academic colleagues and the student friends, the time is very, very crisis time. Information revolution almost all changing us. Internet technologies and allied so many technologies has been transforming the industry, business, as well as the other type of the allied services. Especially my focus particularly on the digital transformation strategy, how to frame the digital formation strategies for the commerce, business, industry during the novel COVID-19 pandemic time. It is all these issues. Along with me, very dynamic and managing director of the Epitronics,
sir, sorry,
Dasari Ramakrishna Garu is with us. Yes.
Yes, sir. Please continue, sir. Sorry.
Ramakrishna Garu is also with us. He is a innovative entrepreneur, a successful entrepreneur also with us. He know real picture of the commerce and trade and business. Today, a different situation is prevailing. I may touch the very, very important points. One of the important points, commerce is a concern. But how far we are preparing ourselves, particularly are developing any norms for industry 4.0 norms already has been following the global companies across the globe. Concern to that, how many the companies that prepared particularly from the Indian side, so what is our status still is actually didn't get any information. Simultaneously, very soon we are going to utilize fifth generation mobile phones, especially technology transforming very different way. Today, some of the global companies, particularly at USA, in European countries, completely almost all 80% of the online businesses has been going on. Their respective deliveries also, particularly the Blue Dart companies, UPS, DHL company, FedEx, TDDC, has been delivering the respective goods and services through the online and with the help of the drone technology. So simultaneously, online business is concerned, Amazon Web Services completely changing the present business. Earlier, suppose we want to export our goods and services to the any respective any country or the different continents, we have certain procedures, we have certain norms and documentation work that we usually fulfilling it. But today, scenario completely, significantly transforming. Amazon company almost all has developed their own strategy, digital strategy. Amazon Web Service, with the help of that, they may touch the and all the continents and all the respective countries with the help of this. So the type of the digitization already developed by them and their services as rendered to the every nook and corner of the world. This way, so many, not only this, very particularly digital and payment is concerned. Payments also significant. Today, electronic commerce and online business is concerned. Some of the problems already is with us. One point of view, people has psychologically, they have their own type of the problems in a conventional way. Still today, the conventional, the things that we have teaching, one is a privacy, security, these are the important issues. Today, all are evaporated, all are completely disappeared. So many third parties now involving, particularly payment is concerned. Especially, you know, well, banks one side, NEFT services, but petty payments is concerned, Paytm and Google Payment and PhonePays and Visa and the card oriented, PayPal has their own type of the payment mechanisms. So a tremendous changes has taken place in this regard, but our preparation also is not a significant. That I want to intimate to all of our academic colleagues. Another third important actually is I would like to touch, but no, workplace completely, tremendously changing. We want to actually work from the remote places. But once upon a time, actually, we want to give any order, sir, we want to actually get any goods, we want to inform the parent companies, and after that, once we order it, then they started to shipping it. But today, as in no way concerned, demand and the supply is concerned, a lot of changes has taken place. Once actually the production is over, without keeping the godown, and the people completely loaded with the ships, and it has started. Our people, required people, purchasers or wholesalers or purchasers or imported, whatever they are just, you know, bargaining and ordering with companies. That type of situation is taking place. That type of what called working environment has a very different way taking place, and particularly in the commerce and business and industries concerned. My dear friends, another important, the how to work it, how to we empower, how do we enlarge our mind to work with the services is concerned, but in this, particularly in this what infrastructure, digital infrastructure, through the only digital infrastructure, a companies only overcome the problem. Otherwise, that particular companies may be differently wash out from this particular cutthroat competition. Reason, so many top companies, especially on online digital point of view, Amazon, not only Amazon, Alibaba and eBay, and especially Flipkart and Tatachia and Rakuten and Crazet company and Taboo.com, Walmart, etc. So many companies already with their digital strategy from the remote places, they are touching the all the customers across the globe virtually. This type of situation that now taking place. But we gear up ourselves very particularly at the COVID pandemic time and develop a different digital strategy. Especially once you look at the wonderful information I have provided those slide, where different situation is taking place. Especially remote places is concerned, still today so many type of the problems are there. All the problems we may
some technical problem is there, I guess, from resource person side.
Distance led across the globe where
sir, your voice is, sir, you just unmuted, sir.
You're not
unmuted. Yes.
Yeah. And Italy, but in especially in the COVID-19 time, the health industry, particularly 2 months, private hospitals is not open.
Your network is not sufficient, sir, I guess. Sir, your voice is not audible. Frequently, voice is disconnected. I think sir has some network issues and he disconnected, I guess.
Hello, are you getting?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is audible?
Yes, sir. Audible also. Sir, try to conclude as much as early, sir. I'm sorry to say that.
Hey. And the online entertainment is concerned. Now, one of the industries affected a lot is online entertainment is concerned. Today, the companies come forward, but once Amazon Prime, but you know, very different way helping the viewers across the globe. So with the help of their digital databases, people are from the homes, they're enjoying all the movies and different type of the programs. But in this way, cinema producers also may change their mindset and change their attitude and develop a different type of the digital strategy. Another important supply chain management is concerned. As I said earlier, logistic management and very different way affected a lot. But even though still today we are facing the problems, but this point of view, whatever the strategy Amazon has developed, same strategy developed by the other companies with sophistication. Through that, we may be able to overcome the existing problems. And another important the mechanism is, once upon a time, printing is concerned, production is concerned, different type of the modules as developed by the technocrats and the manufacturing resource planning and bill of inventory. This type of the models was earlier developed by the technocrats. Today scenario might be different. 3D printing, 3D production came into the picture. With the help of the 3D printing, the production activity tremendously changing. In this regard, we empower, enriched by the Indian industry and business. And especially robots is concerned, especially one of the affected the industry, particularly in India, as well as in the world, is hospitality and tourism. Especially hospitality is concerned, but is so many top hotels, top companies has started to arranging robotics. Robotics for serving and without that using common resources, very different way these people using and serving serving the food to the particularly customers. In this way, a different type of the another simultaneously under the traffic industry is concerned, under vehicles industry is concerned. And different type of the drone technology has been using by the companies. And one side, information communication technology is concerned. fifth generation communication is concerned. Very different situation is prevail, and we prepare ourselves. We develop a strategy. Unless otherwise, so many other problems may be possible to our economy. But this is very high time, one indigenous, one type of movement has started. That is a very, very advantaged nation. We have almost 120 crores of the people we having. Our consumption capacity is very high with compared to the rest of the world. Food is concerned, vehicles is concerned, others is concerned. This particularly, the situation we try to utilize in favor of the Indian industry. In this regard, we frame strategies and other different way we may do it. With this, thanks to the Mizoram University, especially head of the department and the faculty, Jyoti Kumar and Ramakrishna. Thank you. With this, and hand over session to the Dasari Ramakrishna garu.
Thank you very much, sir. First, thank you very much for your valuable contribution to this session. Now I would like to invite Sri Dasari Ramakrishna garu. He is a founder CEO of Aptronics Systems Private Limited, established in 1985, and the chairman of Confederation of Indian Industries, Andhra Pradesh State Council. So, Namaste sir, please unmute.
Yeah, I'm unmuted. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sir. Can I start? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Your presentation is
good. Good evening to all of you. I hope. Just a minute. Let me set my things right. Hello. Yeah. Good afternoon to all of you. I thank Mizoram University for giving me chance to share my thoughts, especially this COVID dimensions, and all of you may be knowing, I need not repeat that. What is that impact on the COVID and how long is there? The only solution will be till the treatment was found or otherwise vaccine is found. How many days it's going to be? That is the biggest challenge. Nobody knows across the world answer for that. So how to handle that? If the both people, one of them has a COVID, there is a 100% chance the other person gets the COVID if they are very near, less than a meter. If the person who is not having a COVID, if he is wearing the mask, he may not get that. The possibility is 50%. If the both are, that is the person who has COVID, if he is using the mask, the other person chances is almost nil. If both are using the mask, there is no chance for the COVID to spread. The other challenges is if somebody sneezes and this is a droplets is fallen anywhere, if that is exchanged through the hand and if it is touches the mouth, that is a face, and then it touches the nose and all, then the, again virus will spread. So these are all the new norms where we all has to work. That is spreading the virus. If you are exchanging any of the material also, there is a chance to spread this virus. So next challenge is, so we have to wear masks all the time. The social distancing should be one meter and wash hands with the soap water continuously. This is what to avoid the virus. This is going to be the new norms in the regularly what we have to follow in the things. So what is the economic impact of the things? That means entire world is impacted in that every business is impacted. The biggest challenge today is three-dimensional impact is there in the economics. One is previously any of the problem, only consumption side is the affected. But today we have impact on the supply side, that is the material side and production side also. That means consumption side, what is happens is now there will be some of the products like pharma and some of the things health related will have a high demand. And the same thing, some of them has the same demand, there may not be much less, but these two types of things are going to be very, very less. Maybe in across the world, something like maybe 10 to 20% of the only things will have that category. But there is some majority of them has a decrease in the demand. As my friend said previously, there is no demand like entertainment and all that area, especially the theaters and all that, and travel and all that has a highly impacted areas. So what is that input material side is the biggest challenge is the availability, first things. One is logistics problem. Because of that, though we have a orders, we may not be able to get the material into our factories. And another direction is the supplier of the raw material has a lockdown and the production is stopped due to the less demand by them, but we need only some few percentage of that. That's where they will not be able to supply that. There is an input material is not available to the other companies. That is another challenge. And machines are broken down and this has to be repaired by some external agencies, other part of the world where the person is not ready to come and the spare parts is not available. These are the various dimensions where input material availability is getting impacted. So with all that, what is that major impact? Now, the one of the statistics, this is a 1 week back or 10 days back statistics, 3.8 crores people lost jobs in the USA. That is 11% of the population of the US. Crude price came down to zero at one point of time. Now it might have reached to 35 per, but the production cost is going to be 45 per dollar. All stock markets down and they might be recovering somewhere. Some of the organizations are not working from last 2 months. We don't know the future, what is going to happen. Nobody is able to tell. So what type of scenarios may emerge? That is a long road to recover. That means today, if you see the entire world, Europe came down, the number of cases or the number of deaths, but the other side, Brazil, Russia, and US still increasing. India is increasing like that. Some of the countries is decreasing, some of the countries is increasing. Another good thing may be passing storm. That means after 2-3 months or something, slowly it all comes down to the normal. It will be normal life. That is all of us will wish. But the another dimension which the people are predicting is going to be roller coaster ride. That means again, when the cold wave starts in the US or the Europe, maybe by November, December, again the second wave will start and again the cases will increase. That is going to be roller coaster ride. These are the predictions where entire world is looking into that. So highly impacted areas is, as previously we are discussing, tourism is a highly impacted area. and entertainment, travel, hotel, education, like that, majority of the areas, every area is impacted, but highly impacted areas are these, and which we have to look into it. In general, all of you may be knowing it, but I want to put it in a place. Economics of organization. Profit is equal to income minus expenditure, everyone knows. In expenditure, we have two dimensions expenditure. I will put it as a fixed cost and variable cost. Fixed cost is something like salaries, interest, rent, depreciation, etc., etc. But what is happening today in industry, fixed cost varies from 25 to 75% based on the type of industry. That means if the fixed cost is fixed, if there is no income, then automatically you can assume that organizations will die within no time. So generally the shareholders' money in the organization is generally the any of the organization has to rotate the money at least minimum, maybe two times or even sometimes four times. That means the total money inside the organization will be 25% of the overall money which is turnover. That means that is a banker's money or the shareholder's money. Again, the banker will use at least 75 to 50% of the requirement. That means in that shareholder's money is again one half or even one fourth of it. That means within 2-3 months, if the company is not holding, doing any business, the total shareholder's money is getting evaporated in the first go itself. That's what is now happening in majority of the industries, which we have to understand that. So the greatest danger in a time of turbulence is not turbulence. It is the act with yesterday's logic. That's all what we are trying to do it, because we are not trying to understand. We have to apply the new mind and new dimensions and how to look into that. That is what is a way forward, which we have to look into it. So biggest challenge today for any organization is how to improve the liquidity. If you have a liquidity, that is like a, you have a cash, that is a blood circulation is there in the body, that's where one will survive. If heart stops, the blood circulation stops, then the people die. Similarly, the liquidity is the heart of the, say, organization. That is a, if that is stopped, entire problem is there. So that's where majority of the organizations is looking how to keep the liquidity upfront. Forget about profits, forget about turnovers. So if I have liquidity, at least I can survive. If I don't have liquidity, I may not be able to survive. That is the mantra which entire industry across the world and industry in India are doing. Even the Indian government also, what they did is they given 10% and 20% for the small scale industries to give a liquidity so that the organizations will not die. Of course, they will lose the loss, they will have a loss and they will have turnover effect, all that will be there. So taking that into the view, what we have to look into? We have to look into the total consumption chain of the organization from the user perspective. That is where understanding the needs of the persons and advertise it and select the product, order it, production, and then delivery, installation, payment, use, repair, all that. This is a total consumption chain. How to optimize in the entire consumption chain is the biggest challenge for any of the organization to sustain. Why we have to do that? Any organization, you have a, one is a component manufacturer, that sub-assembly manufacturer, and then main industry. That's where there will be some of the products may have 5-6 layers, and these type of things will be there. In all these dimensions, we have to see how we can optimize the entire process so that end cost of the product and solution should be less. That's what we need to look into it. So who various stakeholders are affected? One is suppliers may affect, because if the suppliers is not paid by the organization in the what they got in the credit, and sometimes the suppliers may not be, the material may not be lifted from the suppliers, that is one effect. The employees naturally will get affected because the salaries might not have paid or the salary cuts will be there. Somebody may lose the jobs. That is a one dimension. Another dimension is shareholders will get affected, as I talked previously. The other direction is bankers will get affected. If the companies will become bankrupt or may not be able to pay, that may become NPA. Other side, the government also getting affected because we may not be able to pay the taxes, GST, or even income tax and all that. So the revenue to the government also getting impacted. And the other side, the government has to spend a lot of money to the welfare schemes and keep the impact in a more in a contained manner. So all these five stakeholders, that is the customer, government, employee, supplier, and shareholders, has a opposite requirements. That means this is what we need to understand. All of us knows that. So what motivates us to work generally in regular time, it will be fear that where we will work, or otherwise we look for money, or otherwise we look for a fame and power. But what is that today we need to look into is, we need to look into the purpose at which we are working. So what is the purpose of the things which we are working? And we need to have autonomy in thought process, and you need to have mastery in working all that. So this is how the real dimensions of re-looking into the pandemic, we have to look, what is the purpose of all these things which is happening across the world? It is the economic dimension. First important for all of us is a health, how to keep the health of the 700 plus people's lives in a better way. And then how to keep the economics running so that everybody will have a wealth should be there to survive their livelihood. So this is where the direction is. So when you look into the wealth creation, there is a two paths generally will happen. One is consumption chain optimization, that is a productivity should be increased, that is a reduced cost, that is a value to the customer. That means if you are able to reduce the cost, you can give the value to the customer. That means now today what is going to happen is in this type of things, when the consumption is getting reduced, automatically biggest challenge for the people is they try to look for higher value. Unless I don't get more value, which we can do it. One is consumption chain process, that productivity optimization. Another is a applied design thinking, and then identify the needs of the society and how to develop that product, and then innovate the new and create more benefits to the people, value to the customer. This is what is a nothing but a wealth creation. That is what the GDP is getting increased. So what is value? Overall benefits divided by lifetime ownership cost. This is how the value is defined. Today, everybody is going to look for, my value should be more than 2-3% times, then only I will be going to buy the product. Otherwise, I'm not interested to buy the product. So what is the challenges in creating the value? Identify the value, create the value, deliver the value, and scale up and refine. This is a standard way of looking. So in other words, basically, if you want to create wealth, wealth creation can be done only by creating a value to the customer. That is, the sum of the value which you created to the customers is nothing but a GDP of any of the nation or the world. So for that, there is a two ways, as I previously said. One is by improving the productivity, another is by innovation. But both the needs, innovation needs knowledge and creativity. Other side, productivity needs skills and attitude. So this is where the direction at which we are talking about it. So to create value, we apply design thinking to create the consumption chain optimization. These are the two ways which we have to look into the things. So as I previously said, the consumption chain need to be. Now, in a broader sense, to create a value, there are three dimensions which we have to think. One is a design thinking, as I previously discussed about it. The second is we need to understand psychology of money. The second is anatomy of money. Psychology of money means, what is that money? Why you need money? What is that money does to us? How the money is getting multiplied? What is the purpose of the money? All that dimension is a psychology of money. So how the money works basically. What is the interest? What is how you get the profit? How the investments happens? And what is the way the cash flow happens? And how the bankers gives money? And how the shareholders or the stock market works? All that comes into the anatomy of money. Unless we don't understand these three dimensions, it is very difficult for us to look into the direction and get into the purpose to resolve this economic. Because what is happens in any time is basically whenever there is a change, there will be a lot of dimensions which we all work with the old status quo dimensions. That means we don't question the basics. Now it is a very, very important, we need to have a question entire basics. When we are trying to question the basics, first we need to have technical knowledge. What is available today's technical knowledge? Another direction is we need to understand domain knowledge. Unless you don't understand technical knowledge and domain knowledge and merge both the things and create hypothesis and experiment that, and from that analyze the situation and approve the rotate that, thereby we'll be able to improve the things more effectively. This is the approach which we should take it in order to make it forward. So today it's a digital era. That is, a digital as such is able to save a lot of us, in my opinion. If the digital technologies would not have been there in the market, already the entire world would not have very, very panic, and we not have lot of people might have died, and the lot of say pharmaceutical companies might not be able to produce the whatever the drugs and the all requirements. A lot of challenges would have happened, but because of the digital technology which is there in the world, it saved us, in my opinion. Even in railways, which we work for railways, all DRMs and all the senior officers, they by sitting in home, they are able to observe how the trains is moving. They manage the entire railways because of digital technologies, which we built in that. So to get the results anytime, it is a value. Results means nothing but a value creation. To get the value, you need to have capabilities. What type of capabilities we should have based on today's technology? Other side, we need to have change in our mindset and our practices. Mindset plus practice into technology lead to capabilities. Capabilities lead to results. This is the new mantra all of us from educational institutions or the industry has to understand. What type of value we have to create, what type of capabilities we should have, and how to build that capabilities, and what type of practices we should do it, and how to we should start rethinking into these dimensions. Today, technologies are all digital business. That means things also started doing business, not only people and business. That means something, a diesel generator, if you put a level sensor, the moment level comes down, it sends a message to the petrol bank. Petrol banks build the things without any manual interventions. Everything will happen. That is what is a digital business. So the things also started doing business. Today, what are the technologies really working in the across the world? So one is social media. The other thing is mobile technology. Other is analytics. The other one is a cloud technologies. These are the technologies which has a huge penetration across the world. Really, these digital technologies is able to push the world towards the value dimensions and be able to move the world forward. So now the other new dimensions which is already started and going to be there is a Internet of Things. The second is AI and machine learning. The third one is cloud, and the last one is a digital twin. These are the seven technologies which is really drastically changing the world. Apart from the 3D printing, virtual reality, and all other things, blockchain and all, too many other technologies, but these are the seven technologies which really making the things more and more positive direction, and this is going to help us in a much effective way. As for the Gartner, one of the world leading scientists are the trend identifier organization. They say all these digital technologies is going to be advanced at least by 5 years than what they predicted previously. That makes the things more effective in the digital technology. That means all of us has to understand how to work with these digital technologies to make the world forward. What is Internet of Things? Internet of Things has 4 steps. That is the sense, communicate, analyze, and act. Sense, communicate, analyze, act. That means this is nothing but a management. So I sense the get the data, and with that I get the data to the central place, that is through communication, analyze the data, and the take actions, decisions, and then act on that. So that is what is the Internet of Things. So generally the analytics which we are talking many times, we have a data, from there we have a descriptive analytics. We'll be able to see the data in a graphical manner, different way. We use our brain to take the decision and then act on that. So diagnostics is what happened, that is a science talk about cause and effect. That cause and effect will be identified using a machine learning algorithms, and that will helps us taking the less input from human and the better decision and then better action. The next one is predictive, what will happen. Now take for example Google. Say if you doesn't know I have how to go to the airport, if you say that I want to go to airport, it will tell the entire route by itself. That is, it's giving a prediction how much time it takes to reach to the airport. Thereby, I can plan well. The next one is the same thing, prescriptive. The Google itself is telling us how to go to that, the entire decision it is telling. If I push that, that means without our brain, human brain, it is giving the decision and we'll be just following it. Same thing, same information, if I feed it to the driverless car, the car will directly take you to the thing that is directly acting on that. This is how the analytics is working in a more effective way to move the world forward. So for all that, what is needed is we need to have a growth mindset. But majority of us has a fixed mindset. What we do, we have individual mastery. No unfamiliar solutions only we try to do it. Problem solving using the past experience. That's how we work on that. So what is growth mindset? We need to work with the teams, work with the collaboration, and highly uncertainties and pioneering solutions. Problem requirement is the innovation, creativity, and risk-taking. So this is a different dimension at which all of us has to work, and then only we'll be able to solve the problems and we'll be able to push forward. This is way forward to the looking into that. Thank you. Let us adapt and sustain, grow. This is the mantra which we have to do it. First thing is we have to adapt the technologies to sustain, and the second dimension is how we can grow, because this is the pandemic, which is going to be new mantra, new challenges, and nobody knows what is the best solutions, and we all has to invent new solutions in order to move forward. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. It's a very valuable session. And we have some questions from the participants. We all recorded it and we'll send it to you through email. And some participants are also asking for your PPT presentations, both of you, sir. So,
yeah, sure.
So please share those to our co-host. And the validity section, I'm just transferring to our HOD. Please.
Thank you, Ramakrishna.
Yeah, thank you.
Good evening to everyone. We have already completed four technical sessions on this platform, and simultaneously three more sessions were going on in Sikkim University that also have completed. So all seven technical sessions has been completed now. So now we can start our validity session, the final session. I would like to request Professor Abhijit Datta, Dean School of Professional Studies, Sikkim University, to chair the session, chair the validity session. Professor.
Yeah, very good afternoon to all of you. A very good afternoon to all of you, the esteemed panelists, the speakers, and my gratitude to all the vice chancellors who were there in the inaugural session, Professor Khare, Professor Sambhasiba Rao, Professor Rao from Millennium University. They took out their time and gave us precious inputs into the entire day. I think the entire day was very fruitful. We had seen a very nice discussion, very meaningful and well thought out papers were presented. And the best part was that personally, I would say that this was an experience of lifetime for me. And since this is being a collaboration between two departments of commerce from two different universities, and the topic was so relevant, actually. What I thought was that this entire thing of the COVID-19, what is happening, the pandemic, is something which we can term it as a crown that we did not want to wear. Because after all, corona means crown. This is the crown that we did not want to wear, but we were forced to wear. And under this situation, the most important thing that affected us was obviously the trade and commerce, the backbone of an economy. Saying so, I thought that what really happened behind the scene was that we were taken by surprise. And since it was something in which we were taken by surprise, we were not prepared enough for reacting to this. So most of our reactions were a kind of unprepared reactions. And then, of course, the impact of those unprepared reactions might have helped us saving lives, but it really spread out into things which did not kind of brought in the fruitfulness as far as economy and the development of the people are concerned. Now that has become a major point of discussion in our realm of COVID-19 and its impact. Saying so, we had been very often looking at certain things which are happening. One of this which has recently happened was that the skill that was supposed to have been spread across the country because of the labor forces, both blue colored and white colored, had suddenly started migrating back to a different geographical location, leading to trouble which might be seen in trade and commerce later, because the moment the skills move backward, we will have trouble in creating and space for the economy later. The other thing which might happen during this entire period that we saw was our dependence on certain things had been redefined. Say, for example, as the lockdown happened, many of the, this is a real-time experience of the people that I interacted with, I had seen that people had actually been dependent on e-platforms of commerce. But these platforms suddenly failed to deliver up to the expectation of the people, and people had to move back to the physical format of shopping. We understood the meaning of the shops which were right in the corner of our street. We fell back to that mode of purchasing in the time of desperations and the time of lockdowns that started in the beginning. Therefore, we need to understand that over a period of time, we need to create a balance between various trade platforms, e-trade platform, physical trade platform, because otherwise what might happen in due course is that we might lose an opportunity to promote an all-round economic balance growth in trade and commerce. We had, of course, not directly to do with trade, another very, very important segment of the trade or commerce or business, whatever we want to do, is the knowledge business, the business of academics, the business of institutionalized platforms. This was probably very badly hurt. And even today, I saw that most of the panelists had talked about agriculture, industry, stock market, the bullion market. But we had failed to discuss one platform, which is also a very, very important economic platform, that is the knowledge dissemination platform. This platform has also been very badly affected during the COVID, and it is an economic activity, because in our country, about 16 to 17% of income is generated by formal education sector. And that also is kind of getting affected, and I see that it is being under challenge. I'm sure over a period of time, we will be able to live with the new normal. Our policies will generate. These discussions are very important, because as we discuss our ways out of this situation, it will bring in a lot of meaning to our own life and to the society at large. As I end, I would like to thank Professor Bharatendu, Dr. A.N. Shankar, both the university's vice chancellor, Dr. Khare and Dr. Samba Siva Rao, and of course, the vice chancellor of Millennium University, Professor Rao, for bringing us all together and trying to understand what could be the right way out and what are the things that we can do probably in this period of great challenge that we are facing. Thank you all for being there. And we kind of open this valedictory session now for being closed. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor Datta, for giving a presidential note. We are covering almost all the sessions, almost all the presentations we discussed about. He has tried to touch upon all the aspects. Thanks a lot for the speech.
Thank you, Professor Singh sir and Professor A.N. Shankar sir and all vice chancellors. Bartan Singh sir, thank you so much.
We started our session on 11 a.m. morning. And still participants. That is the good
Nice.
Okay, done with. So still we are having nearly 250 participants listening to us. We are towards the end of the program, and now I would like to request my friend Dr. A.N. Shankar to make a brief report of the sessions, all the seven sessions. Dr. Shankar.
Good afternoon, good evening, members of the dais. As a rapporteur, I found that our technical sessions were chaired by Professor V.K. Shrotriya and Professor B. Bharatendu Singh. And all papers were presented there, and it was successfully concluded. The technical session number two was chaired by Professor Ganga Prasad Prasain, and it was supported by Professor N. Rokendra Singh of Mizoram University. There also all the presentations were made, and then it was concluded successfully. Then technical session number three was chaired by Professor B. Ramesh, and it was assisted by Dr. Lal Mangai Fanai from Mizoram University. Technical session number four was chaired by Professor Shivarama Prasad and Sri D. Ramakrishna. They were the core resource persons for the session from the industry and one from the academics. And it was supported by Mr. G. Ramakrishna. Then technical session number five was chaired by Professor N.V.R. Jyoti Kumar, and it was co-chaired by Professor L.S.K. Sharma, head of the department management. Then there also around eight papers were presented, and they were concluded successfully. Session number six was chaired by Professor S.S. Mahapatra, head of the department Sikkim, of Commerce, Sikkim University. And then it was supported by Dr. B. Muthupandian. And there around eight papers were presented, and they were concluded. Then technical session number seven, we had Dr. Krishna Murari. He was chairing the session. He's the head of the Department of Management. And then there again, six papers were presented, and the session was concluded successfully. And it brings me great pleasure to thank our Dean of the School of Professional Studies of Sikkim University, Professor Abhijit Datta, to silently motivate us towards conduct of the seminar and towards the process of conduct of the seminar webinar, and all type of coordination and support that he has extended to us. Thank you one and all. Over to Bharatendu sir now.
Thank you, Dr. Shankar. Thanks for a very brief and very elaborate together. It was very brief, but you have touched upon almost everything. Thanks a lot for the report. Now, at the last stage, I would like to request one of my colleague, Dr. Lalding Liana, whose name our Vice Chancellor also took in his speech about incubation center incubator. So he is my colleague in the department, associate professor in the Department of Commerce. Now I would like him to tell for both of them.
Thank you, sir. And good evening, everyone. And today's webinar, I find it to be very unique, because I have not attended any program where three vice chancellors preside and spoke their mind on any of the webinars. So today I feel this webinar has been a grand success. It's been a good concerted effort of two departments, Mizoram University and Sikkim University, Commerce and Management. And there's one quote which I have found in 1966, a very good novel which says, and which popularized the phrase, "There is no such thing as free lunch." And this event, I think this has been a very true, a standing of that phrase. This event would have not come into a successful pass until and unless some efforts have been made from the organizing or departments. So today I would like to express on record my the thanks from the departments on the vice chancellors, the three vice chancellors who have come together to make and bless this session and webinar. and it has become a success, I believe so. And my Dr. A.N. Shankar from Department of Commerce, Sikkim University, has already mentioned about the technical sessions. And I would just like to mention about our side of the session, where in session number one, we have Professor Vijay Kumar Sotria from University of Delhi, who was giving the keynote for technical session. And for technical session number two, we have Professor Ganga Prasad Prasain from Manipur University. And in technical session number three, we have Professor B. Ramesh from Goa University.
Thanks.
Yes, and from for technical session number four, we have resource person Sri Dasari Ramakrishna, and we have a resource person who spoke quite well, very well on the novel of the digital transformation strategies for commerce and business in novel COVID-19 pandemic. And Professor Abhijit Dutta, the Dean of School of Professional Studies, has already mentioned completely about the whole program, and he has given his thanks from his side. And there's nothing much which I can mention, but apart from that, I think the ICT team from both the universities and especially from the Mizoram University, we are very grateful that they have been sharing their Zoom subscribed platform. And so to the ICT team, I would like to express our gratitude. And I would just like to mention Professor Bhartendu, the head of department, and Dr. A.N. Shankar from Sikkim University. I think both of them have done a very wonderful job in making this program a huge success. With that, I would just like to conclude my vote of thanks. Over to you back, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Madina, for offering thanks to all, everyone. Actually, the thanks goes to the team of Department of Commerce, Sikkim University, Department of Commerce, Mizoram University, the ICT Center. Suraj is sitting here since morning. He came before me and he will leave after me. So a big thanks goes to him. Silently, he is sitting in a corner and controlling everything. We are simply asking him to do this and he's doing it. So thanks to him. Thanks to Madina for having good words for me also. Thanks a lot. Thanks to the three vice chancellors who spared their time. Thanks to each session chairman. Thanks to all. And with this, we finish the program here. But this is not the last. Very soon we will come up with another program. So till then,